When we see changes in bird populations, that's alerting us to changes in environmental conditions. And why that matters is that we live in the same environments as birds. If an environment is not healthy enough to support bird populations, well, then it's unlikely to be healthy enough for people either. For me, my story is a little bit different than a lot of my colleagues here at the Cornell Lab of Ornithology. And many people really got that spark for birding at a very young age. For me, it was more about being outdoors. I loved hiking. I loved really actually playing in the alleys and climbing trees in Schenectady, New York, where I grew up. So nature, even within a city, was what really drew me into this field. The more I learned about birds, the more interested I became in them and really saw how great they were as a study organism because they teach us so much about the world around us. The Cornell Lab of Ornithology is a really amazing place. On the one hand, we're this research and scientific institution. We innovate on the science and technology side of things. On the other hand, we're also this outreach and engagement and education center that engages millions of people around the world every year. And what ties those parts together is our passion for understanding and protecting the natural world and biodiversity. Our work in the Center for Avian Population Studies is really exciting because what we're doing is we're harnessing the power of big data from acquiring the data, to curating it, archiving it, analyzing it, and translating it for use in science and also in environmental decision making. Some of the projects that we're doing that really excite me are related to precision conservation. And what I mean by that is that we're really trying to leverage all of this wealth of information we have about birds and the natural world and to use that to be much more strategic and precise about the kind of conservation we're doing out there in the world. Because what we really need is not just more conservation, we need smarter conservation. And by that, I'm talking about doing the right intervention at the right place at the right time. And that requires a lot of information. And we're fortunate to have that because of the work that we do with citizen scientists all over the globe. Citizen and participatory science is really a way of engaging with people around the world, volunteers, people who are just interested in nature or in different subject matters, and working with them to actually collect data that we can use together to better understand the world and to make better decisions about the environment and conservation. eBird is kind of our flagship project here at the Lab of Ornithology, and it was originally developed to support birders to collect data that could be used by other bird watchers in order to know where species occurred, where are good places to spend their time, to share observations. And initially, there was that aspiration that those data would be useful for science and for decision making. Citizen science has really revolutionized the way we can understand the world around us because it's provided us with more information than we ever had before. And really, when you think of it, there is no way, it's not even remotely possible for professional biologists to be collecting all the information we need about the environment. Citizen science projects that are focused on birds, like eBird, are revolutionizing the way we can approach science and conservation, you know, not only related to birds, but much more broadly. And it's exciting to me to think about how as an individual citizen scientist, you know, going out, collecting information is something that people enjoy doing. You know, it's a form of recreation, but it actually is such an act of generosity as well to everyone else in the world, because that information is empowering individuals, communities, and organizations to make better decisions about the environment, about the world that they live in. Where ornithology can contribute to a lot of these broader environmental challenges we face is by using birds as sentinels of environmental change. Right? Birds are excellent indicators of environmental conditions, right? We often refer to them as the canaries in the coal mine. And that's because birds are everywhere. Different species occur in pretty much every habitat that we see around the world. Many species are very sensitive to environmental change, and they're also specialized in their habitat requirements. What we try to do, you know, here at the Cornell Lab of Ornithology, and especially in the Center for Avian Population Studies, is we try to have as the starting place, trying to really understand what it is that our partners and different audiences care about. When I think about all the problems we're facing in the world, it feels to me too much sometimes to ask people to add another worry to their plate of concern. So instead, what we're challenged to do as scientists, as conservationists, is to find those authentic and compelling connections about what people care about and what it is that we're trying to do. A lot of people think with conservation that we're making a choice between protecting birds or doing things that might be good for human health and well-being. But it's not an either or. Really, it's an and, because many of the same actions that we need to take to protect human health and well-being are in fact the same actions we need to take to protect birds. Those synergies and those connections are powerful, and birds help us to really identify those connections. One of my favorite examples of this win-win is shade-grown coffee. So coffee can be grown beneath the canopy of mature trees. And when we do that, we find that it provides great habitat for many birds, both tropical residents, but especially neotropical migratory species that spend the winter in these coffee farms. Well, it turns out that actually shade-grown coffee also delivers a lot of benefits for farmers and for the environment and also for the whole industry around coffee. Because when you grow coffee under trees, it grows more slowly, so it tends to be of better quality, and then that fetches a higher price on the market. When you grow coffee under trees, those trees are actually enriching the soils, so they're making it more productive as a farm. That reduces as well the need to apply chemicals, so pesticides and fertilizers, and that's protective for human health. No matter which problem or aspect of coffee you're interested in, the approach is the same. Keep more trees on those farms. It's a win-win. What excites me and gives me hope is that it's no longer necessary to try to convince people to care about birds specifically. What I need to do is to show those connections between the issues or the problems that they care about, that they're working to address, and how that relates to bird conservation. So it's the convergence of the kinds of solutions that we need to have, or the steps we need to take, that gives me hope.